this week on Dig Me Out. With your hosts, Jason Ziak and Tim Minichi.
Jay, we're back again with another episode thanks to our Dig Me Out Union on Patreon. You can help us make the next episode happen by joining us at dmounion.com or digmeoutunion.com. And Jay, this is the beginning of a brand new limited series. It's like when they go on, when they have like a new TV series and they're like, no, we're not going to leave you hanging by canceling it after two seasons. This is a limited series. We know there's going to be a beginning and an end.
How do we know that?
Because this is all about diamonds, Jay.
Shiny like a diamond.
Shining like a diamond. Yeah, that was a terrible Rihanna.
We'll take it.
We are talking about diamond releases. Now, what, in the 90s, a couple of albums sold diamond, which is, you have gold, which is 500,000. Then you have platinum, which is a million. And then when you hit 10 million, that's called diamond. And we've already talked about a diamond record, Jay, believe it or not. We've talked about Nirvana's Nevermind.
True.
That is one of the handful of diamond albums. There are some albums, Jay, which are triple diamonds. That's three times 10
that's
million.
Wild. They're all by Garth Brooks.
No, it's like the Eagles' greatest hits.
Okay.
I think AC/DC's Back in Black is up there.
Yep.
Yeah, there's some big ones up there. We decided, you know, we talk about the whole mission statement of the show is telling the story of the 90s through the obscure, the underappreciated, the overlooked, digging into scenes, digging into aspects of the 90s that aren't on the tip of everybody's tongue, like Nirvana. But when we did that Nirvana episode, it was also a really good opportunity to talk about an interesting record and how it fit into the 90s and how it has aged. And we've been kicking around the idea, wouldn't it be cool to talk about some of these big albums and just see how they've aged?
Yep.
Because in looking through this list of albums that came out, I know every single one of them. I didn't necessarily listen to every single one of them because the singles were all over radio. And I kind of feel like you're in the same ballpark, right?
Yes. And I think that's why this was an interesting idea for us to do, is that neither of us have really, I think with the majority of these records, either owned them or spent significant time listening to them. So other than the singles, they're kind of brand new for us. So it should be interesting to go back with as fresh ears as you could have, I guess, having lived through the decade.
So these are the diamond albums besides Nirvana. You have Alanis Morissette, Jagged Little Pill, Creed's Human Clay, Green Day's Dookie, Hootie and the Blowfish's Cracked Rear View, Jewel's Pieces of You, Kid Rock's Devil Without a Cause, Matchbox 20's Yourself or Someone Like You, Metallica's self-titled album, or the Black Album, No Doubt's Tragic Kingdom, Pearl Jam's 10, Santana's Supernatural, and the Smashing Pumpkins' Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness, which is actually quite impressive considering that's a double album. Looking at that list, I've only listened to the entire album for maybe four of those records. So we got a lot to cover. I don't know about you, but I never bothered to listen to Santana's Supernatural. I just didn't. It was not in my, rotation, as were a number of these. To start it off, we're going to go with something that I know neither of us listened to, and that's No Doubt's Tragic Kingdom. That's our first diamond selection for this limited series. We know the singles because they were all over the place. You could not escape Don't Speak.
Yeah.
However,
Just a Girl was pretty big too.
Yep. And Spiderwebs.
Yep.
So take those three songs. There's still 11 other songs on this album.
Oh, yeah.
Now, I didn't realize this, but there are actually seven singles released. For 3 years, they were putting out singles on this album.
Oh, my God.
It actually has an interesting backstory as well, which we should get into here. I don't need to go into the history of the band. I think people know who Gwen Stefani is and how big this band was. This was released in October of 1995. It took 2 years to record this record. It was produced by Matthew Wilder. Does that name sound familiar, Jay?
No.
Nobody gonna break my stride. Nobody gonna hold me down.
Wow. Okay.
That Matthew Wilder. He wrote the music for Mulan, among other things. Like he's a big time songwriter, producer, like behind the scenes. So after their first record came out on in 92 on Interscope Records, the self-titled. The only song that was really kind of a minor hit was Trapped in a Box. That sold about 300,000 in the US. So they decide, okay, next album, let's get a big producer. And it's Matthew Wilder. And they start working on the next record. And 2 years go by. And they turn it into the label. And the label says, this is garbage. We don't want anything to do with this. And they ended up putting it out themselves. It's called the Beacon Street Collection. And it was all the songs that Interscope rejected for what was going to be their next record. Sold about 100,000 copies. I think a lot of it was after all this happened. So they go back into the studio. They spend another 2 years in 11 different studios trying to make Tragic Kingdom. Now, while this is happening, I don't know if you're aware of this, Jay, but there was some personal drama in this band.
Tell me more.
Do you remember such personal drama as bass player Tony Cannell and Gwen Stefani going through relationship issues, specifically that Tony broke up with Gwen Stefani during this period? They were dating. Also, Gwen Stefani's brother was in the band, Eric Stefani. He was actually a primary writer in the band.
He wrote the song Tragic Kingdom on this record.
Exactly. And he wrote, he co-wrote a number of other songs, and he wrote a song called The Climb as well. He was getting mad because he was the guy who's produced the first couple records, and he didn't like Matthew Wilder sort of stepping in and like making suggestions and being a producer. That's what a producer does. Make suggestions. You should try this here. So he ends up just basically walking out on the band halfway through the recording session and giving up because he doesn't want to do this anymore. He's an illustrator or an animator, mm-hmm. and he ends up going and works for The Simpsons.
Wow.
So it's not a bad career move. I mean, to be honest,
I don't know. I think this record was a pretty big payday.
But
I
listen,
guess he still got paid though, right? Because
he still got paid. He's got all those songwriting credits, and he doesn't have to go tour.
That's true.
He doesn't have to spend time in buses and in hotel rooms.
Right.
Driving around, he just collects the check from the songwriting and the royalties, and goes and animates The Simpsons. So that's not too bad. This ended up coming out on Interscope Trauma being the sub-label. And as was mentioned in our comments, which we'll get to in a little bit, but Revelation Records put out the vinyl. And this was the best-selling album that they had for a number of years. Because they would do those deals with major labels where like the major label didn't care about vinyl in the 90s. So like a little indie label would be like, well, we'll press 500 copies of the vinyl for hardcore fans.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, this album blew up. So they kept repressing it and making a lot of money. They also did, he said, Bush's Razor Blade Suitcase was another one that they did that I guess did pretty well on vinyl. So
smart.
Yeah, exactly. This album has 7 singles, Jay. We know that we know the basic ones, right? We know so the first one was Just a Girl.
Yep.
Then you have Spiderwebs, and both of those did well.
Yep.
As singles. And those came out the year the album came out in 1995. 1996 is Don't Speak, number one everywhere except Germany and Austria. Only went to number two. I would love to know who beat it. Maybe it was Rammstein. I guess they couldn't knock Rammstein or Hasselhoff, one of the two, off the charts. But that, I mean, that's how you know how big this album was. Even the singles went platinum. Actually, this Don't Speak went double platinum as a single, which is pretty good for the 90s. I mean, there were some singles that did well, but that's pretty insane. So they released Excuse Me, Mister as the fourth single. That didn't really do anything. Then they released Sunday Morning as the fifth single. That did okay. That actually charted in a number of places around the world and ended up going gold in Canada. And then in 97, also released Happy Now as a single. And then in 98, they released Hey You as the final single for this album. So this was, I mean, this is like Use Your Illusion-esque in terms of its longevity and the amount of time that singles were. I feel like Don't Speak was on the radio and MTV for like a full year nonstop.
Yes.
That's my recollection. You could not escape that.
Yeah, that went hard.
Yep. Then, of course, they followed this up with Return of Saturn in 2000. That had a number of big singles with Ex-Girlfriend and Simple Kind of Life. That was followed by the album Rocksteady in 2001. It was very quick, 2000 and then 2001. And then and Rocksteady had Hella Good and Hey Baby and Underneath It All. And then the final album from the band is Push and Shove, which came out in 2012. I don't know any of the music off of that record. I like the three big ones, Tragic Kingdom, Return of Saturn, and Rocksteady. I know all the singles. Like I've heard all those, you know, bouncing yeah. around radio and stuff like that. But I think before we did this, I had like the greatest hits collection, which is called the singles 92 to 2003. And that's what has the cover of It's My Life by Talk Talk, which was
oh, that's right. Yep.
A big single in and of itself, yep. I believe. Yep. Yeah. So I was looking at who directed their their videos to see, because sometimes you see in the videos like David Fincher directed them, like Aerosmith. Mm-hmm. And you're like, wait a minute. So yeah, I don't notice any of the names here. It's not until like later where Mark Romanek, who's a director, directed the Hella Good video. Anyway, let's get into some of our comments, because people were, they were all over the place, and the poll is going to shake out that way too in terms of how they reacted to us bringing up this album.
But we're still doing the same number of obscure records.
Yeah, right?
this is going to be extra credit. We're doing these on top of that, so
yep,
stay with us here.
Yeah, Phil Fleming said this is one of those records where an identity crisis, moving away from their ska roots, whether they really wanted to or not, and interband conflict, Eric Stefani leaving, Gwen and Tony breaking up, turned into gold. Not every song works, and commercially it was milked for too many singles, but the first three or four singles were some of the better pop songs released in the alt-rock era. Gavin said, decent EP for me, clearly a band of transition and wrote some genuine hits. Just a Girl was perfect. It was a perfect song for the time. An album I had and listened to, but don't revisit these days. Andrew O.C. said, when my wife and I were at Riot Fest, No Doubt and Motorhead were headlining at the same time. I had no interest in seeing No Doubt and grew increasingly angry when forced to watch their set over one of Lemmy's last rodeos. My saving grace is that I told my wife I had to take a big poop and snuck away to see a good chunk of Motorhead set. That's a good... It's a good excuse.
That's a good way. Yeah, I like that. I mean, who's gonna say no?
Right
Who's gonna exactly. argue with that?
No, stay
right.
Didn't you wear your diaper?
And you know, you're buying, especially if it's public, you know, you're buying yourself a good amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, oh, there's a long line, and
yep, you might not even make it.
Stomach's really messed up.
Yeah. Scott Witt said, I was working in a record store when this came out. Seemed like corporate ska. I remember seeing videos and thinking, yeah, this band is done. She's going solo.
Hmm.
Tara McCook said, one of the most disappointing trajectories in music is that of Gwen Stefani, from what she was in No Doubt to Anodyne reality star and Nashville wife. Anyway, this is such a great record. Every track on it is something interesting sonically. Even the comically overplayed Don't Speak plays with the pop breakup ballad in really fun ways. And yes, before you ask, I did play it into one of my high school breakups, except I was the dumper, not the dumpy. Another woman-fronted band, which mattered a lot to me as a kid. I get that the whole ska thing is polarizing. I also know how great that record sounds even today. Excited to hear how you all re-examine it. On the opposite end, Hal Phillips said, I hate No Doubt in a way that is possible when your hatred, only possible when your hatred begins as a teenager. No matter how bad music gets going forward, no matter how awful the next generations of musicians may be, my personal musical Mount Anti-Rushmore will always be Gwen Stefani, Gavin Rossdale, Fred Durst, and then he said Hitler, but Hitler was not a musician.
Come on. Don't go for the easy target.
Yeah. And how Jeremy Ament said Jimmy Buffett.
Yeah, that's
Mike Bankhead. I had this album. I liked this album. I'm interested to hear what Tim and Jay think of the stuff that didn't make the radio. That's our plan. Willie Dillon, this is one of those albums where it's too many album tracks, where too many album tracks pale in comparison to the well-known singles, at least in my opinion. Maybe it's just because I've heard them so many times, but the songwriting seems a lot stronger on those singles. A lot of the album tracks just sound like middle-of-the-road ska. They're more successful when they incorporate elements of ska into a rock song instead of just creating a straightforward ska song. Anyway, better EP for me. Rich Dodgen said, my gut reaction was to classify this as a worthy album, but I've just tried to listen to it for the first time in years, and I found myself skipping through every track except Just a Girl. It all sounds horribly dated, and there's nothing else here that grabs me and maintains my interest, so it's a decent single for me. And then Ian McIver, I remember back in university, a lot of girls on my floor in the residence loving this album, after listening to it, I didn't understand why. Even Next Girlfriend could not change my mind or provide enlightenment. Subsequent albums did nothing to change my opinion of them. At least the video for It's My Life cover perfectly shadowed Gwen Stefani's upcoming solo career because she murders her bandmates in the video. Going back and listening to this album, I still don't get it. Did this album just benefit from timing with the fall of grunge? That's an important aspect that we can talk about. And music looking for a strong woman with attitude in a post-Alanis Jagged Little Pill world. Would it have been the same impact after 1996 with the Spice Girls and their girl power mantra and the rise of pop stars like Britney Spears and their ilk? I've noticed Spears' album is conveniently missing from your list. Yes, there were some other Diamond albums, but we're not covering pop and hip-hop and country.
Yeah, we're going to try to stay close to the rock space.
We need to stick in our...
I have no business reviewing a Britney Spears record. I don't know that I can add anything to the conversation.
Sure. And I don't have anything to talk about with regards to the Bodyguard soundtrack.
Right. I really like Dolly Parton.
I do too. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Love Dolly. So, yeah, let's get into talking about this record. Do we want to go with the standard? What worked? What didn't work?
Yeah,
keep it like that? Okay. All right. Start us off, Jay.
Into the record.
What works for you on Tragic Kingdom for No Doubt?
I think the band shines on this record. Memory Serves, it was all about Gwen Stefani, but as I got into, you know, the 14 tracks here and got beyond the singles, even listening to the singles with fresh ears, but more into the album tracks and the deeper tracks, I really like what the band is doing. Guitar player is got a really simple tone, really plays well in songs, meaning like he's not overplaying. He's often not even playing chords. He's more doing like melodic lines and syncopations and sort of simple things here and there, but they're dynamic and tasteful, and I think sometimes offering a big part of what the hook is. So
you know who he is? He is Ska's Mike Campbell.
Yeah. Maybe. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of like that. It's not flashy or anything, but when you really listen to what's going on in the songs, the guitar parts are pretty important.
Mm-hmm.
Throwing the harmonics in and Spiderwebs, those like pinched harmonics in there, you know, coming from a metal background. Happy Now has that really cool, like surf inspired guitar lead with the big tremolo bends.
You had the best, but you gave her up. Cause dependency might interrupt. Idealistic oil, so hard to please. Put your indecisive mind at ease. You broke the shit now that there's only single, there's no looking back. And the time I'm meeting, are you happy now? Well, tell me how you're happy.
That was a really, really effective melodic hook in that song. Sunday Morning, if you just listen to what the guitars are doing there, they're moving all over the place. There's some catchy riffs and lines, but it's shifting and transforming. you know, that's a good example of a song where the guitar is finding the spaces. It's not taking the song over. And then there's little flourishes like a flamenco style solo and Don't Speak, and then the finger tapping in Tragic Kingdom, you know, as you're hearing all of these different layers also added into some of the songs that are, you know, a little bit more ambitious. The keys on this are also really cool. I forgot they even had a keyboard player in a band. I mean, to be honest with you, as I'm looking at the record, I'm like, that was the first thing that kind of drew me in, was just all the different cool key sounds going on here, from that gurgling synth in Spiderwebs, which I barely remembered that was even in there. But now that I listen to the song, it's a huge part of lifting that song up and creating the melodic glue for that tune, because the verses are can be, you know, so kind of syncopated and weird. Some cool like organ sounds I think are coming from maybe the ska influence, but they're being transformed here into something different. So The Climb has some really cool organ under it. There's a harpsichord solo in Hey You. It's like, oh, let's tear into the harpsichord. The organ in 16 is really cool. Sunday Morning has a bit of like a Elvis Costello flair to how the organ is handled in that. It reminded me of like his Attractions era stuff. Piano and ended on this. It almost reminded me of like, oh, this is maybe the genesis of a band like Panic at the Disco, where it's like this kind of emotional pop dancey kind of thing that's, you know, piano driven or has these other, you know, kind of non-traditional instruments in it for pop music, or, you know, fast kind of up-tempo pop stuff. And then the bass has all kinds of cool moments too. I think the best one is 16. That song might be one of my favorite on the record. It was totally unexpected. It's this real grindy, distorted bass tone. It's a simpler song in terms of like the layering that's going on there. It's very bass driven. It's just such a cool rock song that I didn't expect to have on this record, but with a very different kind of approach in that it's not heavy guitars, it's a heavy bass line that's kind of driving the energy in that song. And then there's, I think, just there's some unexpected album tracks on here that I think are really strong. Like, I genuinely enjoyed them. 16 is one. Tragic Kingdom is just a weird song, but mm-hmm. I kind of love it. It was written by Eric Stefani. It's pretty different. It's a little it's very trippy. It's a little progressive. It's got like almost some jellyfish flair going on in there, with this trippy 60s kind of vibes and some progressive things and some really unusual chords and a chorus that's very weird but awesome.
If you had told me that was a cover from Rocky Horror Picture Show, I would have believed you.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, it has so this like weird 70s rock opera sound.
Yeah. I kind of love it. I could listen to a whole record like that for this band. I think Sunday Morning is a strong track that I was a single, but I didn't remember it. Ended on this, I think it, again, is, you know, this kind of palm muted driving guitar thing, but then this piano pops out of nowhere and really kind of takes over the melody. And Happy Now was another one that had that fun, uplifting new wave vibe with the surf guitar melody line that I thought was, again, unexpected, not what I thought this band was going to be about on this record, and ended up liking it quite a bit. So that's some of the stuff that really stood out to me, you know, the band performance and then some, I think, really strong album tracks. How about you?
Well, revisiting this, obviously you're hitting the singles, and these are, somebody mentioned it about, you know, the singles being among the best in the 90s as far as pop singles. And I agree, like Spiderwebs and Just a Girl, especially the dynamics that they utilize in those songs to utilize the ska upstroke, but to make it interesting in a way that makes it a rock song. So that, I mean, I can hear like the Police influence in that, where like sometimes the Police would utilize the ska upstroke, but it wouldn't necessarily be a ska song.
Yeah.
And hearing the construction of those songs and a lot of dynamics, her vocal is super melodic in those songs. There's pre-choruses and choruses and post-chorus bridges that have really catchy parts. Reminded me of, I'm glad you mentioned like Jellyfish and Elvis Costello, because like the way that they would write, you know, multiple layers of vocal harmonies and melodies and stuff, that like reminded me of that. I have to say, I softened a little bit on Don't Speak. I used to hate that song because it was just so overplayed, but listening to it now with more of like a critical ear, I do appreciate like the actual writing of that song and how well it works. It is a little weird that Gwen wrote it with her brother about the guy she broke up with.
Yeah.
Like writing a song with your brother about that subject matter is a little odd, but whatever. And I think getting into this, I wanted to hear the lesser known stuff. I didn't pay attention to any single beyond, at the time, Don't Speak. Like once Don't Speak happened, I was like, I'm out of this.
Yeah.
Get me out of here. And then like 5 years had to go by before I could listen to another No Doubt song. Listening to it now, it's clear why it was so popular. And the fact that you have Gwen Stefani able to deliver it and be in the video just makes it even more, you know, logical that the thing blew up the way it did. I don't think it's surprising at all.
No, and it followed the power ballad formula in terms of it's the third single. You know, it's accessible, it can be played anywhere, you know, and yeah, it's the ballad ish
and this came out 4 months after Jagged Little Pill. So the, you know, You Know How to Know dropped in July of that year, and then this album comes out a couple months later. So the idea, we talked about it in our episode about the like rise of the female artists in the mid 90s on that round table, but I think like this is definitely, from a timing point and a subject matter point, you have this sarcastic Just a Girl song, which is very like just perfect for the time. Just she could not have timed that better to come out after. You Ought to Know. Grunge has sort of petered out by this point. You know, Nirvana's done, Pearl Jam's gone, not indie, but you know, they're not making videos anymore. They're barely touring because they're in fight with Ticketmaster. Soundgarden's doing down on the upside. Alice in Chains is struggling to stay together. I think, you know, they had the Tripod album either this year or the next year, but with the drug problems of Layne Staley, I think, didn't they open for Kiss on the reunion tour around this time and like played a couple shows, and that was about it? That's what I remember Alice in Chains doing.
Yeah.
So like you had, and you're basically into the second wave of grunge at this point with Bush and Silverchair and those kind of bands. So it'd be natural, especially with like, this is perfect teenage music. So like if you were 11, 12, and especially if you were 11, 12 year old girl when grunge happened, I could see that not appealing to you because that's so male centric. And then this comes along and Alanis comes along in 95. And you can see how, I mean, after this, you get so many artists that are probably would not have gotten any sort of attention in the first half of the decade. But, you know, you get your Tracy Bonhams and your Meredith Brooks and those kind of people. But I mean, all the way, like you can draw a connection between like this and Pink or this and Katy Perry. There's a lot of the girl empowerment, girl power, that sort of element to this, which would go, you know, on the pop end with Wannabe and the Spice Girls and that kind of stuff, like a year later.
You can kind of make the case that at least Just a Girl feels like a transition to that point, because they're taking a similar message and twisting it to be sarcastic and doing it with a wink and a smile.
Mm-hmm.
But the underlying message is similar to what you would hear from maybe, you know, a Riot Girl or something like that, where it's,
right,
you know, be done with more anger and aggression. And this is them saying like, hey, yeah, I like that message. Or what, how can we spin it and do it in a way that's much more accessible, right? People can nod along to it. They get the message without being repelled by it. And then that continues on maybe into the 2000s, you could say, to even become more accessible. Then it just becomes like a jingle almost in a cliche at that point, in terms of girl power. So this feels like it could be a stepping stone to there.
When I was listening to this and placing myself in, you know, this time period back then, it didn't feel like there was a precedent for this.
Right.
I couldn't think of like, oh, a band that sounds like this doing this thing. And I realized that like, A, them being this successful probably got a lot of those other ska bands signed. Like, I believe that Save Ferris said they basically got signed because they were looking for another female fronted ska rock band. But then I also started thinking like, well, is there any like precedent? Like, is there anybody who sounded like this before? And the only thing I could think of, because obviously the Police are different, and
yeah,
we mentioned, you can talk about like a song sounding like this, but in terms of this setup, was like Blondie.
Yeah.
And I think that's interesting because she went solo as well, but not as a successful outcome. But that's it. Like, I was trying to think of, even in the 90s, like there wasn't anything like this. So I think that's also what caught people, you know, so off guard, and why people responded to it.
Yeah, that was my reaction at the time. I mean, when Just a Girl and Spiderwebs in particular hit the radio, they just stood out. I mean, the musically it was different, and then, you know, her vocal style is different. It's got a ton of personality in it. You can hear the sarcasm. She does that really well.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, the ska elements were, you know, I think different at the time, but there was something about it's like bright and clean. And I think at that time, but it's still rock.
Mm-hmm.
And there wasn't a lot of that on the radio, at least that I remember. So this really cut through like a knife in terms of that. And I'll go back to the guitar playing again. It's a great example of like, you know, you don't hear guitar in pop music anymore, really. You do, it's like acoustic guitar chords or something. But this is a good example of like how you play, you know, cool, interesting electric guitar in a pop band. Unfortunately, like producers after this, like maybe couldn't find other people willing to do it or could do it. And like, just to forget it, it's not worth trying to figure out. But like, I think this is a really good example of like, at that time, you know, it still could fit in rock radio because there, you know, had guitar in it and had that edge, but the guitar playing was so song oriented and not overbearing that it also crossed over immediately to pop and became super accessible to a much broader audience than just alternative, radio. Don't Speak helped a ton with that. Mm-hmm. But even those first two singles felt like different in that way.
People mentioned in the comments, at least a couple people, about this being a transitional album from the pure ska of like their early stuff. This, they start to reduce the ska. And yeah. I believe at the end of the Tragic Kingdom tour is when they got rid of the horn section.
Okay.
Like they basically announced like this is the last show. And they were stripping it down to just a four piece since Eric Stefani had left as well. And then it would go pure, like there's some ska-ish stuff happening, but it's very pop on the next couple records. I think it's interesting that like Don't Speak is essentially one of the oddballs on this record because A, it's a ballad.
Yeah.
Ska bands don't often do ballads.
Right.
And if you think about the history of like ballads with regards to pop music, that's when, if you look back less than 10 years ago, that's when hair metal was like at its creative peak, but its commercial peak. Was when every band could nail a power ballad for MTV. And it's interesting because after this, you get like the Goo Goo Dolls' Iris. Like power ballads kind of come back into vogue in the second half of the decade. I think that's when Brick happens with Ben Folds, probably around this time, 95, 96.
Yep. The industry figured it out. It was like, oh yeah, this is really the same as before. Okay, got it. Like, we were disoriented for a couple of years, but now everything goes back to the way it was.
Right. Because there, I mean, not that there wasn't slow songs, like, Stone Temple Pilots had a couple, like Creep was a slow song. And
they had heavier Big guitars Empty,
but they weren't power ballads. They weren't ballads in the way that like Don't Speak is.
Right.
And Alice in Chains is the same thing. Like Roosters. it's a slow song. It ain't a ballad. So like being, it's a little bit edgy to put a ballad on this record, which is completely bizarre to say, because this is not an edgy album in that way. But there is a lot of like interesting choices that I don't think if they had failed so miserably on the first attempt to make this record, that they would have taken the chances.
Hmm.
On this record.
Yeah.
Like clearly them getting shot down by their record label saying this thing is a complete disaster, put it on your own and start over, made them go, look, we can't just rely on upstrumming our guitars and doing, you know, ska rock. We gotta like come up with something a little bit more interesting.
Yeah.
I did actually say to Katie, I was like, I wonder if, you know, we mentioned Matthew Wilder was the producer. I'm like, the singles are so good. I wonder if they like how many rewrites they went through. Did they get input from other people, like outside writers, just like feedback and stuff? Because they are so tight, and so well put together. Not that the rest of the album is like terrible in comparison, but those are like super well written. And I guess, you know, obviously with Wilder there, that helps. You get a lot of feedback from a guy like that.
Yeah.
He's not just there to push the record button, but
for sure. Something I thought about for Spiderwebs for sure. I think there was another one, maybe Sunday Morning too. That's one of the few songs I can think of. I didn't do exhaustive research here. I'm going off the top of mind, but you tell me if you can think of any, where it's a big hooky chorus, you know, hit radio song and it's played double time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that is pretty unusual. right?
It is. Yeah, today you can't get a song above like 90 beats per minute.
Yeah, I mean, that snare is just cranking. It's just tink, tink,
tink, tink, tink, yeah, tink. It's super fast.
that struck me. I mean, at the time it didn't seem unusual, but now listening to it is like, oh my goodness, you would never hear a song like this on pop radio. Holy moly.
Yep.
It gets way too aggressive from a rhythm standpoint.
So what on the record doesn't work for you?
When they go into the, you know, just basically ska band mode,
mm-hmm.
or blues band mode, or disco band mode,
mm-hmm. When they go genre,
yeah, and they don't vary it up. You know, I love those elements creeping in through the other songs we talked about, but you know, different people is a good example of like, okay, it's a ska song.
Mm-hmm.
The Climb is like the 6/8 ballad feel. It's kind of bluesy. It almost feels like they're trying to write Queen Somebody to Love, but they're not quite.
And it's 6:40. Like there, what? And it's
way too long. I mean, there's some interesting stuff that happens in that song.
Yeah.
It gets weird. Like in the same way Tragic Kingdom turns into like a, you know, this weird bizarro circus thing. It's just not as interesting as a song.
No.
You Can Do It is like, I don't know. It sounds like Jamiroquai. It's like this funky disco tune with horns and waka waka guitar.
It sounds like, yeah, disco. I was like, what is happening? Why are we doing disco?
World Good Round is like a reggae. I don't know. And lyrically, it's not great, and it's just kind of corny.
Yeah.
So, yeah, when they're in this safe space playing genres. Pretty straight, not a compelling band.
Mm-hmm.
When they're mixing that up and keeping you guessing, like where are they going to go next? Oh wow, they're like, Don't Speak. You know, it's this kind of finger pick dramatic verse, and then it turns into this Latin kind of vibe for the chorus. One example of like, okay, that's kind of interesting. And then you've got something like Tragic Kingdom, when you're like on this carnival ride. Mm-hmm. With these really bizarre chords, and you know, so a lot of the stuff we talked about, there's these just really cool juxtapositions of faking you out, you know, starting ska but then flipping it another way, or bringing instruments together that don't normally go together, or whatever, and that works great. When they don't do that, it's like vanilla, you know.
Yeah.
not super interesting.
I'm right there with you. Like I was absolutely, when I first time listened through and You Can Do It comes on, I just like stopped what I was doing. I was like, what the f- is this? it made me mad for a minute. So it's like, oh, are we getting into dumb songs now? Like, yeah. When they just stick to a very simple concept, not only is the song kind of boring, but I don't feel like she does much melodically. No. Because it gets locked into those rhythms and it doesn't, there's nothing there from a melody standpoint to like catch on to.
Look, she's great on this record, but I came away from it with Time and Distance really, like I said, when I led with what worked, appreciating the band a hell of a lot more than I did at the time.
Mm-hmm.
They were just so over focused on her and the marketing, it was hard to even pay attention to them. But when you just listen to the record with as fresh ears as you know as possible at this point, she's very good. But she does not, like when we did Four Non Blondes, you know, Linda Perry just elbows her way to the front of that record. Mm-hmm. We just did the gets, and it was the same situation. Like, Mia Zapata just pushes her way to the front of that record. And you're like, oh yeah, I guess there's a band here too. But man, I'm just listening to this singer because it's so compelling. I didn't have that experience listening to this record. You know, vocally, it's fine. She's an interesting singer, but it was not like she was heads above them. You know, it was to me very much a band record, which I ended up enjoying quite a bit.
And I remember seeing at the time, like, I mean, they were a band that like got in a, you know, a crappy old van and toured on their first record, you know, very low cost, you know, gigging it out. And I think that's when they had the horn section. They were like taking a horn section around with them too. So, I mean, if anybody thinks that they weren't like authentic, that they came, like they were somehow, you know, put together, which it's not. Like this was a band, a real band.
But you can see and hear, I think you're touching on it with like the quality of the singles here. I think you can even see it in like the album cover. Like some industry folks got a hold of them and said, look guys, like I know you enjoy like being a ska band here, but here's how you sell this, right? One, go listen to your producer. Two, you know, put Gwen in the forefront of the album cover and put the other dudes in the back, like literally like 4 miles in the background standing in a field. And I'm sure they were like, I don't know, man, this doesn't feel right. And they were like, look, do you want to like have a career in this business or not? And they were probably like, okay. And I'm sure after that, when you look at the album covers, they don't do this anymore, right? The album covers are like graffiti, or like the last one was like 4 equal pictures of each member.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I'm reading into like, this is a little bit of like selling your soul to the devil. I think it's do these things, you will be successful. And also you will be potentially trapped by this going forward now.
So. Right. In some ways, I mean, you know, I agreed with you about what didn't work. I was thinking about this in terms of when it came out and how it hit. Like, this is in some ways a necessary response to the, you know, downtuned grunge hard rock of the 90s. And this is almost like new waves, you know, poppier response to the punk of you know, the Ramones and Sex Pistols and that kind of stuff, where new wave took it in a much cleaner and more radio friendly direction. And this just kind of seems like the necessary reaction to it, to all that was happening. Like, you know, I went to concerts, and when you went to see Stone Temple Pilots, it was a particular type of crowd. And if you go to see No Doubt, that's going to be a different kind of crowd, and they're going to be having fun in the way that like a crowd that goes to a pop concert is going to be having fun. Although, I mean, there's obviously going to be ska fans there as well. But if there's ska fans there, it means there's going to be some dancing. So it's like kind of a big cultural shift as well in terms of like the concert going experience. Like the dominant albums and the dominant records are no longer mosh pit based.
Yeah,
they're becoming more inclusive in terms of, you know, everybody going. Obviously, we don't, you know, this did, I think it did 8 million around the time. And then it, since then, it's caught up to like 10 million. I don't know where it's actually sits right now, but now it's listed, you know, top 1000 albums of all time, you know, those kinds of things. And it's got all sorts of awards for being for sales across the world and whatnot. I don't feel like, I know Gwen Stefani has a status because of, she's been on shows, and she had a solo career, but that kind of petered out after like basically one record.
Yeah.
I don't think the second record did nearly as well as the first one, or it's either the second didn't do as well as the first, or the third didn't do as well as the second. I don't exactly remember, but
she seems like one of those people that's just a celebrity now, and it's getting to the point where like, I don't even know why. You're just like, right. Hey, that's a famous person. What do they do? And you're starting to forget, like, oh yeah, she was in No Doubt. Like,
Yeah, let me see. What was the Love Angel Music Baby was the second one, second album that had The Sweet Escape. I don't know if that did as no, The Sweet Escape was the second record. Love Angel Music Baby is the first record. That's the one that had Bananas, Holla Back Girl, What You Waiting For, which was written with Linda Perry, Rich Girl. I mean, oh, this that first album had a ton of singles. Jeez. That's 2004 as well. So within a 9-year span, you get Tragic Kingdom, then you get the follow-up Return of Saturn, and then Love Angel Music Baby, her solo record. I mean, and oh, you got Rocksteady in as well. I mean, that's a ton of hits in a 9-year span.
Yeah.
That she has got a lot of co-writes on. No wonder she's a celebrity, because she's basically he doesn't have to do anything. That's why she doesn't have to make music anymore and tour, because she can just be a judge on America's Got Talent or whatever, or America's Next Voice person. What's it called?
Yeah.
The Voice show? The Voice? Is it called The Voice?
I think so. Yeah, I guess. I mean, I don't follow the band that closely, but I'm not aware of like anything notable that the rest of the members of the band have done either, which is odd. I mean, I could see one way, like, he probably made a lot of money from these couple of records, and you don't need to, you don't want to, but I don't know. They feel like a little odd that you haven't seen him in other bands or doing other things.
Probably. Yeah, I know. I think Tony Cannell's done some like songwriting and producing for other bands, but not like a ton. Oh, he wrote a song for Weezer on their Hurley record. He worked with All Time Low and some other ones, but there's not a huge discography of
it's kind of just maybe just doing interesting things when they come along, but not feeling you need to, which is nice.
Right.
I think we all want to be there.
But I wonder what the cultural impact is of their music. I know Gwen Stefani's present, but like, I guess this gets probably played on alternative radio that plays classic alternative now. I don't know.
Well, I mean, there was a rush of, like you mentioned, I think a ska signings and, you know, a brief moment there where it felt like, oh, this is going to become an enduring aspect of rock music. I mean, at the time it felt that way.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause it's, again, it's one of the forms of what they stumbled on here, right? Was a bringing ska in so that it's danceable and also accessible in how the instrumentation works. And obviously they proved that it can produce hit songs. And then you saw a bunch of other bands start to get signed and, you know, sort of a little scene or like movement started to happen. And then it very quickly fizzled.
Yeah.
I suppose none of those other bands really had the songs that this band had, but it certainly felt at the time that we were going to get a lot more of this for a lot longer. And they themselves didn't even really, I mean, I'm somewhat familiar with the material after this. I don't remember anything really ever sounding like this stuff.
Right. It got more pop after this.
Got very pop and R&B and sort of like whatever was going on at the time they were.
Yeah.
They sounded like.
Well, in terms of the ska thing, I feel like after the grunge stuff starts to implode and slow down, it just becomes a genre hopping exercise for the rest of the decade. Like you get this moment where like, oh, is it going to be ska? Nope. Is it going to be swing music revival? Nope. Is it going to be electronica like the Prodigy and Chemical Brothers? Are we all going to have synthesizers instead of guitars? Nope. It kind of like bounced around a little bit before landing on new metal as like the dominant rock genre to end the decade. And it was just anything alternative was getting signed, and then there'd be these, you know, cohesive sort of sounds that would all get lumped together, even if they, you know, didn't necessarily play together or know each other. And that kind of just, it was because there was so much money flowing around. There was just like any alternative band, if it's alternative, we're going to sign it.
Yeah. I mean, the thing, so I'm kind of listening to the Return of Saturn, and there's elements of the songwriting that's there, but like they start to use electronics.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that increases more and more. On Tragic Kingdom, I mean, this is all playing. There's no drum machines on this. It's all real drumming. There's a lot of keyboards, but it's all performed. It feels like this is the capturing a band that's really tight, plays a ton, has taken a couple passes at writing these songs, got with the producer, made them even better. There's just a lot of time and energy into both the playing of these songs and the production of them that is very difficult to sustain. Right. I think a lot of bands, you see this in their career, especially as you get more into the 2000s. Like, if you have any whiff of commercial success, you start to see the bands like playing less together. They start using more drum machines. Like, it just becomes this whole, I mean, you know, Maroon 5, for example, like early on, it's like, oh, this is a band. And then later on, a couple albums later, you're like, what? This is just another pop song. Or the Killers, you know, the first records, you know, all performed and sounds super urgent and you can tell it's a band. And then later on the records, you're like, I don't know, it just sounds like a singer and a bunch of like studio people. I don't even know. Is this still a band thing anymore? So it also is one of the examples, maybe the 90s, the first examples of that happening, where it goes from band to like, as they get more successful, it becomes more about like just making hit songs. Whatever that takes.
Yep.
Not necessarily playing together, you know?
Yes. Let's talk about our overall rating for this diamond 10 million selling album, Tragic Kingdom, which unlike like a lot of the 10 million diamond sellers, you can find a lot of used copies of these CDs.
Yeah, for sure.
It's funny how many people, I mean, you could even 20 years ago.
But it's going to be hard to find those original 500 vinyl.
Yes.
Maybe Vadim still has one somewhere.
I wonder how they must have compressed the hell out of that, because this is a 59-minute record.
Jeez.
So, and I don't think probably they did a double terrible album. Yeah, it's probably. Yeah.
Yeah, that's rough. Or it's a couple, it would have to be a couple discs.
Maybe three sides.
Yeah, maybe.
Something like that. Land on this record? Is it a worthy album, a better EP, or a decent single?
I've got 10 songs that I genuinely think are really strong. So I'm going to go with a worthy album. Obviously, there's some filler here. I think you could drop a 10. If this album was, you drop those songs and it was just those 10 songs and seven of those are singles, you're talking about like Cars territory.
Mm-hmm.
Like when you listen to what record is that? Shit, that's self-titled debut, the Cars.
Yeah,
when you listen to that record now, you're like, holy shit, every song on this record is a hit.
I mean, it's
like
the first Van Halen record and the first Boston right, record too. Like,
yeah, exactly. If they edit this record down a little bit, they're in that, I think they're in that space. You got seven singles and I think 10 songs that are all high quality pop songs.
Mm-hmm.
Where you at?
I'm right there with you. I mean, I would cut World Go Round, You Can Do It, The Climb, Different People, and I think that's 10 incredibly strong songs. I like when this band, I think this is probably where the cutoff is for me, because I like when this band does interesting stuff. Like in the closing track, Tragic Kingdom, where it's a little weird.
Yeah.
And that's probably Eric Stefani's influence. Yep. It's interesting because he can write such an interesting song like that, but then write kind of a dull song with The Climb.
Yep.
But stuff like that, you know, Spiderwebs and Just a Girl, like those are just killer singles that I've been able to sort of reappreciate now that I'm not completely, you know, over the band because of getting overplayed. So yeah, it's a worthy record, which I didn't expect. It took me a while to come around to accepting that. Because I think my hatred of Don't Speak going into this had biased.
Look, when I went into this, I fully expected to be bored to tears with it. I'm going to be honest. Between like, over the oversaturation of the singles and then my impression that this was going to be a lot of like, you know, second tier ska.
Yeah.
I was pretty surprised.
Yep. We're both surprised at what we've done here, which is to talk about a record that a lot of people have heard, and maybe we've said something new and interesting. I don't know. You'll have to tell us in the comments. You know, we're on all the socials. If you're not aware, we're on the Facebook. We're on the Twitter, the Instagram, the TikTok. I throw memes out there on the TikTok, by the way. Usually they get like 200 views, but occasionally like a few thousand people like a 90s music meme. So if you like those sorts of things.
Something catches fire every now and then.
Yeah.
A little nostalgia.
You know, well, like I threw up a Beastie Boys
one,
and it got like, you know, all the Beastie Boy fans. Well, the thousands of them on TikTok. They were happy. So that the socials is where you can leave some comments, maybe your opinion on this record. If you think we were on target, let us know. If not, let us know as well. Our poll at Patreon. This is interesting, Jay. The winner was Better EP with 52%. It beat out Worthy Album with 26% and Decent Single 22%. So, I can understand if you are not into this album, if you weren't into it then, I doubt you'd be into it now. I at least appreciated, even though I wasn't familiar with ska, I at least appreciated the first couple singles before I got sick of the band. I didn't run out and buy the album, but at least I was like, yeah, that's a good song.
Yeah.
We're going to do this again. You know, maybe next month, maybe we've got to see what the schedule looks like. Maybe a couple months from now, but we've only got these number of albums. You know, this list of albums that we gave you here, we're going to knock them out one by one, go through. And people are very excited for us to talk about Creed, Kid Rock, Santana.
Oh my goodness.
Matchbox 20.
Some of these I'm genuinely interested in. Like, hey, I've never heard that. I wonder, you know, what's like this one. I did have a little bit of a.
Right.
Because I kind of like Spiderwebs at the time. And I thought Don't Speak was a clever song. So there's part of me like, oh, you know, I am kind of interested to hear what the rest of it is like, expecting it to be ska, but still. But there's some on this list where I don't know, man. It's going to be rough.
I'm especially looking forward to Melancholy and Infinite Sadness because it's a double album.
Yeah.
There's so much going on. And I loved every minute of it when it came out. Yeah, like I went to the midnight sale. I was like in love with that record. I think I still have my receipt from when
that
I
might
bought
be
the
one
record.
Of the few, that we both owned when it came out and listened to quite a bit.
Yeah. Yeah. I was pretty obsessed with the band. I was buying European singles, like,
oh my goodness,
CD singles, trying to get like B sides. First off, like that's how into the band I was at the time. So I can tell you that has not maintained over the years for various reasons.
Mm-hmm.
If you would like to join our Patreon community, join our union and vote in polls like this or for our roundtables or for our monthly tournaments, you can join us at dmounion.com. or digmeoutunion.com. That's how you join the union. Support the podcast. Keep us keep the bills paid. And we've got a nice Discord community that talks about stuff. And when they talk about interesting stuff, we might talk about it on here as well. Or they might share a video for a new song like we did a month or two ago. We checked out that Hold Steady song. So we've had some new stuff pop up. We might need to give some things to listen here in an episode or two. I know there's like a new Extreme album coming and I haven't heard that. I haven't heard that single yet.
Yeah, that would be, there's supposed to be, the album's coming out in June and there's supposed to be a couple more singles released. So we'll either do that one or maybe one of the next ones.
Got it.
It's the first album in 15 years. they joked that it's taken them longer to make this than Chinese democracy took.
It's true.
Which is kind of mind-blowing. Time is just moving so fast now. I often find myself just completely lost in how long.
Well, because when we started this podcast, it was the 20th anniversary of everything, and now it's the 30th anniversary of everything.
I can't process that.
Yeah, neither can I. I think that's why people go crazy as they get old, because their mind can't process the fact that they're getting old, so they just go bonkers.
You know, time is an illusion, so.
I thought it was a flat circle.
That's that too.
Okay. Well, which one is it? All right. Patreon, that's where you go. Patreon is also where you can read the Box newsletter, which comes out every weekend. Our release calendar of 80s, 90s, and aughts relevant music, books, podcasts, you name it. We talk about it we list it in the calendar, and we do two reviews every week of new releases. And if you'd like to suggest an album for one of our monthly poll tournaments, go to digmeoutpodcast.com, where you can also sign up for the Box newsletter. And if you like what you heard, Apple Podcasts is where you go to leave some kind words for the podcast. That's it. For Jay, I'm Tim. We're out, and we'll be back next week with another episode of Dig Me Out.